Some judgments are particular, some A are B. And then Kant says, for epistemological or transcendental purposes, we must add the singular judgment. He adds this because otherwise the table doesn't look quite so neat. The singular judgment is a judgment which functions like a universal judgment, but which is the subject of which isn't the name of an individual thing. X is B, like Socrates is mortal, as opposed to all men are mortal. That's the quantity of judgments. The quality of judgments, they can be affirmative, negative, or infinite. Affirmative is A is B, negative is A is not B, and infinite is A is non-B. This is an old distinction going all the way back to Aristotle, if I'm not mistaken. There's a difference between saying that man is mortal and saying that man is not immortal and saying that man is non-immortal or something of the sort. It's not an important distinction for Kant's argument, but it fleshes out the table. And finally, there's the modality. A judgment can be asserted problematically, possibly A is B, or asetorically, A is B, or apodictically, necessarily A is B. Now, if you think about it, you have three sets of three. And if you combine them, you have 3 times 3 times 3, which is 27 different judgment types. For example, you could have a universal, affirmative, problematic judgment. That would be possibly all A or B. Or you could have a particular negative, asetoric judgment, or apodictic judgment, which is necessarily no A or B. Or you could have an asetoric singular infinite judgment, X is non-B. There are 27 different possible combinations, 3 times 3 times 3. And as I think I mentioned, maybe even during my very first lecture, way back when my graduate apartment mate, Charles Parsons, were running a Kant study group in our apartment, our friend Sam Togus got it into his head that these 27 possible judgment types corresponded to the 27 subsections of the analytic of concept that Kant introduced in the second edition. And we had this big uproarious argument about it. I thought that was a nutty view. Sam, who didn't really believe it, but thought it would be fun to defend it, defended it to the death. Philosophers do that, by the way. I'll just tell you one brief story that I witnessed myself. When I was a graduate student, the Graduate Philosophy Club was tasked with the job of inviting visitors to speak. And Harvard was very strange in one respect. When a distinguished visitor came to speak, none of the members of the department would show up at the lecture. This was marvelous for the graduate students because we got to ask questions. It was a little weird for the visitor who would show up and none of the members of the department would be there for his or her talk. But Rogers Albritton showed up to give a talk which was a job talk. That is to say, he was being interviewed for an assistant professorship. So the whole department showed up. This was, I think, the first time in a very long time that all of you had been in the same room together. And they didn't really quite know how to behave. So it was a little odd. Anyway, Albritton gave his talk, which was a very recherché talk on the third man problem in Plato. I mean, it was something that most of us knew nothing about, but Albritton was quite brilliant. And came time, I was chairing the meeting. I was the treasurer of the club that year, and I was chairing the meeting. Came question time, every member of the department raised his hand. And I panicked. I mean, you know, these were my professors. Who do I call on first? So I retreated to tradition and called on the oldest member of the department, Raphael Dumas, and went from there. Well, John Wilde asked a question, and he got into an argument with Albritton about whether forms could participate in themselves in Plato's theory. And Wilde was saying that forms could participate in themselves. And Albritton said, well, does that mean that the form of man is a man? And Wilde, who never backed down from a position, said yes. At that, Quine struck him as an interesting claim. And he said, Donald, do you mean that the form of a man has arms and legs? And Wilde said, yes. And the two of them got into this uproariously funny argument, which the rest of us just collapsed in laughter. And poor Albritton, who was there for a job interview, thought he had taken a wrong turn and had wandered not into the Harvard Philosophy Department, but into the local mental hospital. At the end of the hour of questions, all the members of the department summarily left, leaving me to take care of Albritton, who was by this point shattered. And I took him back to his hotel room, and of course he thought, well, that's it, I've blown the job opportunity. So naturally he got the job and was a brilliant member of the department. But at any rate, I can't even for the life of me remember